Should you work out when you're fasted? So if you're intermittent fasting, should you work out? Should you train? Should you lift? Should you run during your actual fasting period? Or should you wait until your fed period? And if you do train fasting, should you train at the beginning of your fast or should you train towards the end of your fast? What's gonna get you the best desired outcome when it comes down to fat loss, when it comes down to performance, when it comes down to VO2 max, whatever. Let's talk about all of it and also explain why, but give you some tangible things that you can take home with you to really have a practical application of what I teach in this video. Hey, if you haven't already, please make sure you hit that subscribe button. You're tuned in to the internet's leading performance, nutrition, and fat loss channel. New videos every single Tuesday, Friday, and Sunday at 7 a.m. Pacific time and a bunch of other videos in between. And also, make sure you check out highly.com as you can check out all the premium performance apparel that I'm always wearing in my videos. Okay, I'm gonna open this video up with a basic study. This study was published in the British Journal of Nutrition, and it took a look at 27 studies overlooking 273 different participants. Okay, and the general idea of this study was just to see, plain and simple, over a larger scale, if training fasted allowed you to use more fat. And by far, this study that was published found that there was a significant increase in fatty acid oxidation, fat burning, in those that trained in a fasted state. And this is particularly talking about an aerobic state, but still, for all intents and purposes, it leads us to believe that you can burn more fat training in a fasted state. This is generally pretty true, and it has to do with the fact that your insulin levels are lower, okay? Insulin is the absorptive hormone. It's going to slow down fat loss because insulin is going to block the catecholamine response. It's also going to block hormone-sensitive lipase, okay, which allows fat burning to occur. But the other thing is that when you're in a fasted state, your sympathetic nervous system is activated a lot more, meaning you have more adrenaline, more epinephrine, all that, which is going to act upon the different enzymes that allow fat burning to occur. So let's dive a little bit deeper into the fat loss side of things specifically, and then we'll talk about performance, we'll talk about weight training and all that. So this study was published in the Journal of Applied Physiology, and it was a longer tail study. See, it was a 6-week study, and the whole idea of this study was to see what happens over time when people actually work out or train in a fasted state. And it was pretty darn interesting. You see, what they found after 6 weeks of training in a fasted state, there is a huge increase in fatty acid binding proteins. You see, what these binding proteins are transport proteins, and they move fat from the intracellular portion of a cell over to the extracellular membrane of the cell. Now, this may not sound all that fascinating, but essentially what this means is that when we train in a fasted state over time, we literally train our body to have certain proteins that mobilize fat for us from the intracellular membrane to the extracellular membrane and vice versa, basically allowing fat to move within the cell a little bit easier. This is huge. Again, it sounds small, but 6 weeks of training in a fasted state allowed fat to be transported a little bit better. But when we actually start talking about how fat burning occurs in a weight training state or an aerobic state, we have to look at something known as intramyocellular triglycerides or intramyocellular lipids. These are lipids or fat droplets or little triglycerides that are inside our muscles, literally inside our muscles. They're just kind of interwebbed there. Okay, so there was a study that was published in the Journal of Physiology that found that when you trained in a fasted state, you mobilize these intramyocellular lipids 60% more than if you were training in a fed state. So what that means is that little fat droplets, little fat cells that are inside your muscles, like inside your biceps, your quads, and all this, they get activated and they get mobilized if you're fasted, and they don't get mobilized as much if you're fed. This means that they go into the bloodstream and can be burned for fuel. This is catapulting you into a state of fat burning, and this is occurring whether you're weight training or doing cardio. You're activating those. So these fiber type specific intramyocellular triglycerides are very, very important to us. But the study also found that glycogen uptake increased dramatically, meaning that when you trained fasted, you had the ability to basically uptake a lot more glycogen after a workout than if you were in a fed state. So this means that you burn more fat, but you also store more in the way of glycogen, which would be essentially your fuel for the next workout, because you're always going to use some glycogen. So this is pretty cool. Not only do we improve our fat burning, but we also improve our recovery as far as muscle glycogen is concerned by training in a fasted period. And this would apply if you were training as deep into your fasting period as you can go. The longer that you can go, the more result that you can get, period, as far as this goes. Which leads me into the next world, which is talking a little bit more about endurance improvements and talking about actual performance improvements as far as VO2 max goes and everything like that. And this study took a look at participants over the course of 4 weeks that were doing some type of cycling. So they were going like a bike ergometer. Okay, so what they did is for the first week, they had them cycle for 25 minutes, and they separated them into a fasted group and a fed group. So for 25 minutes, they rode and they measured their peak wattage, they measured their VO2 max, they measured a couple of things. Okay, then each week, they added 25 minutes to their ride. So by the end of the 4 weeks, they were doing 100 minutes. Okay, but the last 3 and 4 weeks of this study, they had the fed group go ahead and add a maltodextrin shake intra-workout, so in the middle of the workout, and they had the fasted group add a maltodextrin shake post-workout, so like a breakfast after the workout. Well, the results that they found were pretty darn interesting in terms of VO2 max and overall recovery and things like that. So they found at the end of the study that the fasted group had a 9.7% increase in their VO2 max. The fed group had a 2.5% increase. Okay, so we're talking over 3 times the increase in your VO2 max by training in a fasted state. That's pretty wild. Okay, then let's talk about glycogen uptake. So after the workout, who absorbed more in the way of carbohydrates into their muscles so that they could have more energy for the next workout? The fasted group had an increase of 54.9% in their glycogen uptake. Compare that to 2.5% increase in the fed group. Now they both had an increase, but I'll take 54.9 in the way of overall recovery uptake versus 2.5. Now the one thing that I will say the fed group actually had an advantage on, and that would be taking a look at how efficient the body was at being able to take glycogen from the muscle and then immediately turn it into a glucose that's used for fuel. So the fasted group ended up with 17.1% increase, and the fed group ended up with a 19.1% increase, which makes perfect sense though. The fasted group was becoming more efficient at using fats. The fed group was becoming more efficient at using carbs. Now carbs are gonna give them more immediate energy. So sure, we could argue that there was ultimately kind of a 2% performance increase in the ability and the efficiency to use glucose, but I will gladly take a 2% decrease in my performance for an increase in VO2 max and an increase in glycogen uptake. Okay, so this tells us again that over time, if you just make training fasted, whether you are intermittent fasting or not, a regular thing, you're going to have a lot of success. Okay, it also implies that when you're training in a fasted state, your glycogen uptake is gonna be a lot better. So this leads me into the muscle building side of things, which is gonna help us understand the timing side a little bit better. The Journal of Applied Physiology found that when you trained in a fasted state, you produced 2 times more the amount of something known as P70S6K. Okay, this is a specific enzyme that allows the muscle building process to occur. It's acted upon by mTOR, which stands for mammalian target of rapamycin. This is the whole anabolic world. So when you train in a fasted state, you increase this P70S6K double from what you would after a normal workout if you were already fed. Now, this stays elevated for a period of time after the workout, and it peaks around an hour, but it decreases and goes back down to balance at 4 hours. So after 4 hours, both the fasted group and the fed group had the same levels of P70S6K, which means that you have a limited window to build some muscle if you're gonna train in a fasted state. So here's what I recommend. Okay, here's the timing, here's what you've all been looking for. If you're looking to build muscle, you're actually gonna have a better result waiting until the end of your fasting period, working out, and then breaking your fast post-workout, because that level of P70S6K and mTOR is gonna be elevated, which therefore allows you to burn more fat, but also build more muscle when you have the fuel in place. So you wanna break your fast after your workout. It sounds crazy. You're gonna feel a little bit weaker, you're gonna feel more fatigue, but metabolically, you're gonna have 2 times the catalyst that's gonna allow you to build muscle. So wait until the end of your fast, train, and then go ahead and eat. Now, full disclaimer, I train in the morning. I train towards the earlier part of my fast, and I still seem to hold on to muscle and build muscle just fine. But I can say by looking at the data and looking at the research that fasting will help you build some muscle if you train at the end of your fast and then add the food there so that you can actually get your desired result. And of course, you have to be in a calorie surplus. You can't just magically eat a small amount of calories and have it all go to muscle and be able to get away with eating 500 calories. So the short is, train in the morning if you're looking to just burn fat and you're looking to keep your performance a little bit higher. Okay, aerobic performance and athletic performance as far as your strength goes and your anaerobic performance. Train in the morning. You'll have a little bit more in the tank and you'll have all these fat burning enzymes that are gonna allow you to continue to burn fat throughout the rest of the day. If you're looking for muscle building, train towards the end of your fast, but do note that your strength will be down a little bit. It's not all about strength. It's about what happens after the fact. So either way, your performance might decline a tiny, tiny bit. But once you get adapted, you're gonna become more efficient. So hope that this clears some things up and helps give you a solid understanding to why you should train in the morning, whether you're fasting or not. As always, leave your comments down in the section below, and I'll see you in the next video.